I was reading the AI capacity constraints post on semi-analysis, good work by Dylan, as usual. In it, Dylan and the team profile NVIDIA's H100 AI superaccelerator, a monster of a GPU that costs something like $20,000 and is not for gaming. This GPU uses an interesting new type of memory, high bandwidth memory, or HBM, from the Korean memory maker SK Hynix, namely the HBM3 variant, the first commercial product to have it. Dylan also mentions that AMD's own forthcoming AI accelerator, the MI300, also uses HBM. Ever heard of this type of memory before? What is it? And what makes it the preferred choice for these AI chips? In this video, a deep dive into the special memory powering the deep learning revolution. But first, let me talk about the Asianometry Patreon. Early access members get to see new videos first, as well as selected references for those videos. Early access helps a lot, and I appreciate every pledge. Thanks, and on with the show. HBM does not refer to a special type of dynamic RAM memory cell or special chip. Rather, it is a standard administered by the Joint Electron Device Engineering Council, or JEDEC, for interfacing the DRAM and the compute. HBM introduces the concept of stacking the DRAM dies and running many independent memory channels through the stack. The goal is to provide very high data rate transfers for more advanced computing applications, like those for AI, which are more amenable to parallelism. The vendor can also choose to add a logic-based die, as is shown in the JEDEC spec diagram. This additional logic is for redistributing signals, test logic, and other external communications. JEDEC standard defines for the manufacturer how the HBM system has to work, and what features they need to support. It helps with the commands and signals sent through the memory channels in the DRAM stack, for instance. But it does not specify how the vendor might structure the stack, nor does it specify things outside the stack. This allows various HBM vendors in the memory industry to offer a differentiated product. HBM buyers can put your HBM stack right on top of your CPU or GPU die, or do what AMD/NVIDIA did, which is to add a silicon interposer to connect multiple HBM die stacks to your GPU, like a PCB. JEDEC also administers other standards like DDR, LPDDR, and GDDR. DDR is the standard you might be most familiar with, used for general-purpose memory modules like those you put into your PC. The traditional memory interface standard for graphics cards is GDDR, or Graphics Double Data Rate. Right now, they are on their 6th generation, GDDR6, and there are a few gaming cards using it. So why do we need another standard? There are a few things about GDDR that make it less suitable for heavy AI processing. First, while each new GDDR standard does feature higher data rates, they also employ a point-to-point connection. This means that each memory channel connects to just one module of memory. This is in contrast to HBM, where channels run through all the modules in the stack. GDDR's single channel makes it harder to scale the system's total memory capacity because it means we have to scale that single module's memory capacity, which essentially requires us to shrink down the DRAM cells even more, which is hard. I did a whole video about this a while ago discussing the 3D DRAM cell. Future shrinks seem to require new capacitor structures like the pillar, which may or may not be actually manufacturable. By vertically stacking the modules, HBM makes it conceptually easy to raise the memory capacity. There are also some physical size gains as well when it comes to horizontal floor space being taken up by more memory. More capacity is good because it means we don't have to go to the secondary memory systems, hard drives, etc., for more data as often. In April 2023, SK Hynix unveiled their latest HBM3 chip with 12 layers and 24 gigabytes of memory. This is an expansion from the 8 layers you had on prior HBM3 configurations. Second has to do with how we do memory bandwidth. Bandwidth refers to the rate at which data can be read from and stored in the memory. It has a few major components in it, the clock frequency, the number of data transfers within each clock cycle, and the width of the memory bus. So, if we want to get a higher rate, then there are a few levers that you can pull to go about it. You can raise the clock frequency, or the width of the memory bus. GDDR features a relatively narrow memory bus, which limits how much data we can send through at any one time. So, GDDR gets a higher bandwidth by ramping up the clock speed. So think of it as kind of like a thin but very fast moving stream. GDDR6's narrow and fast approach is great for tasks that require a lot of sequential calculations, streaming data, complex physics calculations, rendering frames. But here's the downside. Higher clock speeds are a formidable engineering challenge and consume more power. This is in part due to having to distribute clock signals throughout the chip, and also that the transistors in the memory chips and the memory bus have to switch more frequently. And with higher power consumption, there is also more heat. And of course, electricity is not free. At some point, you are bumping your head against the system's overall power budgets. So the approach that HBM takes is referred to as wide and slow. We widen the memory bus, 1024 bits per HBM3 stack, compared to DDR5's 64 bits, while operating at a lower clock speed. This makes it a slow-moving but very wide river. The result is that we are able to transfer more data while consuming less energy on a per-bit basis. I dug up a 2013 slide from the AMD announcement claiming a 40% decrease in memory power consumption while boosting system performance by 65%. NVIDIA is making billions selling AI accelerators, so it's interesting that the HBM standard that their accelerators use comes from AMD. AMD started on what would eventually become HBM in the 2007-2008 time period as they were working through the broader technical issues around die stacking. In a 2015 interview, Brian Black, senior fellow at AMD and said to be the godfather of the chiplet, explained that his team started architecting HBM after seeing the limits of GDDR, back then GDDR5 rather than GDDR6, especially when it came to power consumption. So in 2011, AMD announced that they were partnering with SK Hynix to develop something to essentially replace the GDDR standard, particularly with regards to this power consumption issue. Key to making HBM work are these channels running through the DRAM die stacks. These are made up of what we call through-silicon vias, or TSVs, and microbumps. Your typical HBM package has thousands of them. TSVs are basically very small holes drilled into the memory dies in order to very quickly transfer data down to the interposer and on towards the CPU or GPU. TSVs were chosen because they are shorter and thinner than alternatives like wire bonding, which also contributes to less parasitic capacitance. These little silicon channels also take up less real estate, and all of this contributes to higher speed and less power consumption. The downside is that TSVs are challenging to manufacture. We generally use deep reactive ion etching to produce these, which is a form of anisotropic etch that cycles through steps of adding etchant and then an inhibitor. There are also substantial packaging and test challenges. It's not easy to test the 10,000 plus TSVs on the HBM die, and if any fail the test, to repair them. Despite the challenges around microbumps and TSVs, ultimately what AMD found to be most challenging was the ecosystem. The first commercial product to incorporate the HBM standard came out in 2015, AMD's Radeon R9 Fury GPU. Brian Black related that the product didn't encounter any single overwhelming technical challenge, rather, the biggest problem was working through a very long list of all the quote-unquote newness, as in identifying smaller technical challenges, identifying a solution, and then onboarding technical component partners to overcome them. For instance, SK Hynix provided the HBM for the 2015 GPU, but UMC, the Taiwanese foundry, had to produce a silicon interposer suitable for it, and ASE, one of Taiwan's leading outsourced semiconductor assembly and test vendors, had to figure out how to package the whole thing together and test it. Constructing the supply chain and the supply ecosystem surrounding this new product is an underrated part of commercialization and success in the marketplace. Since then, there has been two more iterations of the HBM standard, HBM2 in 2018 and HBM3 in 2020, with added improvements. The H100 can be equipped with either HBM3 or HBM2E, which is a later modification of the HBM2 standard. Prior to ChatGPT and the AI boom, HBM was not a big market, about 1.5% of the larger dynamic RAM market. But it is growing. According to the market tracker, Mordor Intelligence, interesting name, the HBM chips market is forecasted to grow from $2 billion in 2023 to $6.3 billion by 2028. Currently, there are three major suppliers of HBM memory, two of which are Korean. SK Hynix is the leading supplier, having pioneered the standard in conjunction with AMD. According to a recent TrendForce report in mid-2023, Hynix has little over half of the HBM market, with 53% share. Second is Samsung, which fiercely competes with Hynix. They are not standing still. TrendForce pegs their market share in 2023 at about 38%, though it seems like Samsung's people disagree with that. Both companies are investing ₩1 trillion each to expand capacities at their fabs in South Korea. SK Hynix's current fabs are in the city of Incheon, but they are opening new capacity in a fab in the city of Cheongju. Samsung's core HBM line seems to be in the city of Cheonan, which used to host an LCD factory. According to news reports, their goal is to double their HBM3 capacity by the end of 2024. Third is Micron, which is the only American supplier, but a significant laggard with only about 9% market share. In July, they announced that they had started sending out samples of their latest generation HBM3 memory, which also has 12 dies stacked up high. HBM is for the Korean memory makers, like the H100 die is for TSMC, a small little bright spot in an otherwise dour memory market. In the second quarter of 2023, SK Hynix turned a loss of about $2.2 billion. For that same quarter, Samsung announced a 95% decline in operating profit from $7.5 billion down to $500 million. Just another day in the volatile memory business. AMD never envisioned HBM as being a GPU-only thing. At the time of the Hynix collaboration announcement, they mentioned other uses for HBM's lower power consumption. Think constrained environments like those on the edge. I think automotive has a lot of potential since there's so much optical data floating around, but price and qualification might be an issue. In the end, right now, it's all about AI. AI has turned this rather sleepy high-end section of the market into the hottest new thing. The effects of this impact are still making their way through the rest of the supply chain. All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you guys next time.